So good evening, everyone. I'm sure today the presentation which was given here from the channel partners and from the management side must be very, very informative to you. And we all have learned together. So as a part of when we before we conclude, we need to have a question answer sessions, and those all the questions have come through chat box. So I have summarized those questions here, and I would like to ask those questions to the forum so that we can actually hear from them the main what is the reasons of it and how are we going to take forward from here. So pricing is the questions on price increase. There's a lot of questions has come. So I would try to summarize all of them in one place and would speak, and then we'll expect those answers from the management here. So let me start and try to complete all the inputs which has come here. So on pricing, the first input which has come is time for implementation due to customer looking for it, and mostly they want 45 days. That is that is a question which is there. And proposal which are bid for 2020 and with the orders which are coming now, how we can get a price protection. Also, there is one more question on pricing is that partners and direct customer should have uniform pricing as far as PNF and freight increasing pricing is required. Broadly, very similar lines. I'm seeing that we need some time for implementing. So broadly, on the time, the questions are there. So would you like to please share your thoughts on that?
Very good evening to each one of you, and appreciate you having given in these questions. All of these questions definitely need an answer, which we try and give you over the next 40 minutes. So this question which has been put across, I think there are four or five of you who have raised similar questions. So let me take it one by one. So the first point is with regards to when a price list needs to be effective from, though the announcement can be made on an X date, can it be effective from a Y date? There is also a point which was mentioned that some manufacturers, I think it was Siemens that was mentioned by Jacob, stating that they give a leeway of a period. So my answer to that is that there is a challenge in giving a leeway of an X period, 1.5 months, 45 days prior. Having understood the reason and the area from where most of you are coming, because you would have given quotations to your respective customers, and there would be certain cases which you would require to hold on the prices because the end customer is somebody who you have committed to. How I would like to address this is that for specific cases where you can get it validated from our respective regional heads in your territory, we can possibly consider that. It obviously cannot be for a longer period of time because you are aware that the steel prices have gone through the roof. Just to put this in perspective, the steel prices in our previous price list, which was 2020 price list, was at 52,000. And the current price list that we do have, we have priced it at 62,000, and the current steel prices, which are prevalent as of this morning, is close to 77,000 rupees. So we are talking about something which we would not have seen in our entire careers, which is anywhere between 40 to 50% increase in the steel prices, which has a direct impact on the costs of the product. And for sure, you'll appreciate that this particular industry works on very thin margin, and this has to be passed on for our survival, both yours and as well as Rital's. So having said that, we would go the extra mile to support you for genuine cases where you require our support. The regional heads are on the line. They would validate your cases and support you for a limited period, which could be for the month of January, so that you can tide over for specific projects and not for stocking requirements, as we'd want you to sort of adapt to the new prices immediately. So this was one point. The second point, which I think had come through, was can we have a a price which is inclusive of freight. It's a tough one. I think in Angsana, when we had our last meet in 2020, so the same question had come about. We are pondering over this question, whether we can tell you that, list price minus discount plus 5% or 7% for freight as well as packaging forwarding. That's something we've not been able to, because different parts of the country would have different formulas too. But we take that input again, and we have had a project working on this, but it was inconclusive so that we couldn't implement it. So with that, I would request some of my other colleagues, maybe Ajay, to add on to what I've said.
Good evening, first of all, to all the partners. I think we haven't met for some time now. I think it's high time that we have a meeting, face-to-face meeting, but I think it's another couple of months, I believe, that we'll be meeting. I think Matthew has answered how do we deal with situations where there are quotations in the market. But I can tell you a couple of things, here, just to add to that. It's a force majeure condition right now. This is not a normal increase one is talking about. Every year, we don't increase. Sometimes we have increased. We are given the validity higher because it's a normal increase through inflations. That can be managed for a month or something. But this cannot be managed, Whatever orders we are getting today, it is a loss to us. So understand that I think we're bleeding right now. So the situation has to be dealt very, very business-like situation. There cannot be any emotions about it. And you have to give quotations to your customers with a very less validity right now. The time has gone when we are saying, it's a 3 months validity and 1 month validity. Today, nobody knows what is the ceiling on the steel. It's not in our control. It's not in your control. And therefore, we need to protect ourselves. We don't want you to bleed. And certainly, you do not want Rittal to bleed even for a shorter period, And I can see that happening already. The orders that we are logging right now, they may be at 54, 55, 60 rupees of steel. Today it is 76. The steel quotation that we're getting from the market is 2 days validity. Now listen to me what I'm saying here. The steel companies are giving a quote for 5 days, 6 days validity. You give me an order today, I'll stick to the price. That is the situation we are in the market. So it's not our fault, and it is simply... people have opportunity to make money, and they're making money. Let's face it. And there are two bigger companies to even talk about it. They have all the support from government and everybody else. So I think we have to protect ourselves. We'll do what we can do without bleeding, of course, and without getting into losing market share. That is also very, very clear. But believe me, you have to review all the quotations, talk to regional heads. And wherever possible, change the quotation value. Don't worry about losing order. The BCH is increasing by 20%. Envent by 17%. Pyrotech, I have spoken personally to some, guys, and they're increasing by 20%. So don't worry about that we'll be priced out. I saw that question also, that we'll be priced out. No way. Today with 10% increase, that is on average, the competition is looking at 20% right now. We are watching right now what is happening. So don't worry about losing market share, but play smartly so that you don't lose the customer, don't lose the margin, but play very, very, and be in touch with the regional head, because this is not something you can do of your own. Talk to Stanley, talk to Rahul and other regional heads for any job which has a substantial value into it. I'm sure we can find a solution out there, right? But the best is get pricing from customer. That's the solution. There's no other solution. How much can we support? How much you can take? None of us can take the hit which is on table. 60% increase. Unheard of, right? So let's make sure that all your open quotations are shared with our colleagues, without any, hidden agenda, and get to the level that we, jointly address the issue for short term. And in midterm, in another, couple of days, I think we got to implement the price. There's no other way, actually. Yep. Thank you very much.
Just to add to what Ajay mentioned, 5th of January, soon after we increased our prices, BCH has increased their prices by 17 to 20%, as Ajay mentioned. That's with immediate effect. Their quotations also for, special projects, etc., have limited validity. In fact, prior to their price increase, each quotation had a validity of only 2 days. Only 2 days. As goes nVent, they are controlling it from the pricing standpoint in the sense that whatever quotes that they give, they are not going on higher discounts. But we have news that their price, if not increased, would be increasing by the 7th of February by approximately 20%, because that's when they have an internal operations meeting in which this will be declared. So we are, you know, we would find that we are on par with competition. Nothing to worry. We are there. We need to win projects together, and which we will. We will not lose. Thank you.
Thank you. So I think this question is for Chandra. AE boxes like 1180, 1073, 111114, 1280 are not available at your end. Is there any plan on speeding up your production at your end? We have orders in hand for these boxes.
Hello? Hello?
Yeah.
Of course, it's available. We have been producing at the rate of 1,600, 1,400 per month. But if there is additional demand, for sure, we will ramp up and produce. There is a small gap which was there, and that we try to close that gap. And last 2 months, we have been producing. Further, if there are any gaps, we are definitely open to close that gap.
Okay.
So there will be no issue. We will be definitely be closing if there are any huge requirements.
Maybe just as an assurance, since the question has come about on the delivery, we would be more than pleased to take this question and the quantities basis the sales order. And Chandra will try and take it forward to the extent possible. We'll check the stocks and try and see that we fulfill your requirement. Chandra?
Yeah, sure. We'll definitely fulfill that. Please take it forward through all the proper route, or whatever the demand. We'll try to fulfill that. Should not be an issue.
Okay, then. Thank you. So the next question is status of IEC 61439 certification with Siemens switchgear in case of aluminium busbar. And in continuity to that, the question for SBUB, the pricing, the validity of offer is only for 30 days, but most of the time the projects are getting finalized only 3 to 6 months time. So the validity of the pricing has to be 90 to 180 days.
So I'll address these two questions. The first part being in terms of aluminium testing. As you would have heard during my presentation, we are done with ABB testing, so that's available. The aluminium solution is available. We have certain advantages that would be mentioned in our catalog, which is almost ready for circulation. As goes Schneider, as I did mention, by mid-year, though we would finish the test by March, but I keep a time period until mid of the year, maybe by June, we should be ready to go with Schneider. With regards to Siemens aluminium solutions, we are taking it a little slow at the moment. We would first want to, you know, work on ABB and Schneider prospects, try and see how we are going forward. And with our learnings, we look at Siemens if it be only in the next year as we progress. So as of now, there isn't a plan for testing the Siemens solutions for aluminium. That's point number one. The second part or the second question that you did have appreciated that the offers that are being given at the moment is only for 1 month for reasons that we have just mentioned to you that steel is going through the roof. None, believe me, nobody is able to comment or forecast how steel would be for a period as large as 6 months. Albeit even earlier, our quotes were valid for a maximum period of 3 months, which we have brought it down for 1 month. As things stabilizes, basis your feedback, we would definitely go back to a longer period, which could be 3 months of validity, which we will definitely do to support you. And we understand the problem of a 1 month validity. And as I mentioned to you, whether it is nVent or whether it is BCH, all of them are forced to have lower validity for reasons that we just mentioned. We cannot be having business conducted with such a fluctuation, you know, companies would have to close down. So I would expect you to truly appreciate. We can discuss if there are specific cases, not that we can have the validity. We can probably jointly define a strategy on how we should quote for a specific customer, that could be a risk that we can take together. But that would be at a price which may not be as competitive as you may want it to be. But yes, let's work together. Time being, we will go with the 1 month. As time goes, when it still stabilizes, we will go with higher validity as suggested by you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So this question is to Dev. Most of the partners are working with us since 10 years. In critical market situation, do we have any plans of giving them additional payment terms with some kind of a softer interest rates?
I think we had proposed a channel financing scheme at one point of time, and we have been discussing with a lot of partners at that point of time, and we made a very good presentation. I think I don't know how many presentations I made to Germany for that reason. But unfortunately for Germany, they don't accept any financing scheme. So indirectly, so we had to come back and again keep the level of the credit period what we have already kept. And I think it's fair enough because as of now, I think 60 days or whatever we have kept for the channel partners. So I see that they should be able to mobilize their funds during that time, you know. So I feel, I don't know, Jacob, what you have to feel about this in that sense. Because in the market situation, 60 days is good in that sense.
So I'll just add on. The question is quite relevant that many principals do, tie up with banks for a channel finance facility. And directly, indirectly, that's the question, whether... at a cost, whether we could give additional days of credit. There was, a time when we had to take a decision of what credit period should be given to our partners. There are certain principles that give 30 days credit, some give 45 days credit. We've chosen to give, depending on volume though, a 60 days credit period to our, first level of customers, which is you. Now, we took this decision for the fact that we knew that there is a time for rotation, the cycle of business you give to your customer. He then, makes the panel supplies to his customer and there is a rotation which is involved, which could be, it could be 60 days, it could be 90 days. But then the entire amount can't be borne by just one principal per se. So we all chip in money to actually make good those credit periods that they expect. Having said that, basis the feedback that you had given in 2020, and we had made a presentation, if you remember, with regard to a channel finance. We had made this proposal to global management, the proposal was not, approved, if I may. And hence, at the moment, we are not in a position to take that decision of channel finance forward. We shall try and work on it and revert back when we have some good news. So at the moment, we would offer you the 60 days credit with which you should try. If not, maybe with your own OD facilities, which you can help you to sort of try and look at the additional days period that you'd want to. But that may not be the ideal solution. I accept the fact that it could be a channel finance. We shall push further and try and see how we can make things work. Not a commitment, but we shall try again. Thank you.
Also, another thing is basically for the channel financing, channel partners, of course, we know that we have the regional offices, regional mod centers where we stock and sell, for them. So there is already an inventory carrying cost so that we can give it in shortest time possible time. So we have that cost also what we are bearing as of now for the channel partners, which may sometimes don't bear it for the direct customers, So that kind of facility. So practically stock and sell within 24 hours or 48 hours they're getting. So they have the 60 days to mobilize what you're saying.
Okay, thank you. So this is question on freight. What will be the retail strategy to reduce the freight impact on partners since they are not able to discount offered going forward by almost 7 to 8%?
Yeah, the freight is a good question, first of all, because this is something we have been at it for a couple of years now, and we try to, and therefore you can see the investment that we have done in regional logistics centers today. We are the only national company who is, operating out of Bangalore, but if somebody wants, say, standard box out of Calcutta, he gets X Calcutta warehouse, right? And that cost sometimes is 9 to 10%, which is borne by retail. You know, and same thing in Delhi, 6%, Pune, 3%. So, you know, so of course the customers who are in the southern part of India, they get that benefited a little bit more than east and west. So I think we already have done this. I don't want to share the number, you know, how much investment we have in regional logistics center, but there's a huge investment for rentals and also the inventory that we carry. Only point is that we want to deliver faster and at a consistent freight from a warehouse. Now, you know, if you are in Indore, for example, or if you're in Bhopal, yes, you have to pay certain freight from Delhi or maybe from Pune or from Ahmedabad. I think that is something is part of the business. This is cost of doing business, what one has to do. But as Rital, if you ask me, I think we have done fair amount of investment to make sure that we are not unreasonable and telling everybody that you take from Bangalore and pay me 10% higher in Eastern versus Karnataka, which could be 1% actually. You know, so we have kind of gone away from there. It was the case a couple of years back, but we have brought to a more rational. So I don't think we are going to add, you know, logistics centers. So we have five of them right now. And I think that's more, you know, reasonable and realistic way of running business. And as I said, we do take care of all the inter-warehouse freights, actually, which is not, by the way, small amount. I mean, it's a very, very big amount for us. But that's part of doing business. Same thing, you guys have to do it. You know, there is a cost of doing business. And I think the customers have to pay for it at the end of the day.
Just to add to what Ajay mentioned, I give you a corollary with maybe a switchgear industry. Now, you know, you could probably have 1 crore worth of switchgear packed into one truck and material shipped, where you could possibly have the freight borne by a switchgear manufacturer. Unfortunately, the industry that we are in, we are actually shipping air, if I may, or space, if I may, and it is a voluminous product. So you would find that the freight cost remains the same, whereas the value would be for what you are. So inter-warehouse from Durbalapur to our warehouses, we are bearing the cost, which is very, very huge. And we expect that you recover from the customer the charges which are for either local or if they are specials when they are from Bangalore. And this has to be inbuilt in your quote to the customer. Either you want to say it is X discount plus transportation, or you reduce the amount, the quantum of discount that you're giving to the customer. But the fact is that neither you nor us should be or would be in a position to bear that kind of freight, which is reasonably huge and which needs to be factored in the pricing with the customer. Right? Thank you.
Thank you. So there is a question on...
Let me just add one more. You know, for IT business, we did start a flat pack design a couple of years back. And the idea was to reduce the freight. So, for example, if you are sending a PS, which is 42U cabinet, of course, like Matthew said, it's air being shipped. You know, it's very expensive, actually, air being shipped. Now, you convert that to 6 parts, which can be stacked and, you know, can be dispatched. Now, the freight comes down to what goes up is a packing cost now. You know, because each of the item needs to be packed differently. Now, so there are solutions. In my opinion, it's a question of business requirements. It's a question of, are we going to sell? We created this product, never got sold, actually. You know, and that also helped some of the partners to stock it because you don't need huge space for a stocking. So these designs are available with us, were available with us, but we have discontinued that 3-4 years back because we started, we created stocks and nothing moved out of the stocks, actually. So I would say talk to Vinay or talk to Stanley. And industrial, we're not doing because the requirement of IP, etc., very tough there. So we don't want to get into that mode of flat pack. It has never been successful for industrial players. But IT, it has happened. Globally, it has happened. In India also, I have heard that some guys do it. So, you know, if somebody can discuss with Vinay, and we can look at that to reduce the freight cost, etc. But that's the only thing that comes to my mind of, you know, how do we reduce freight cost? Otherwise, as I said, our geographical, you know, locations, a regional logistics center is a way to reduce cost, you know. We also tried, by the way, train movement, you know, that can train reduce the cost. But, you know, to be very frank, that also doesn't reduce the cost. You know, they are monopoly player. The Indian Railway is a monopoly, right? If you want to use, there's no other way. I don't have a private railway company who can take my material, you know. So you have to pack it, then the first mile and the last mile connectivity in terms of transportation. The end-to-end costs are higher than even trucks. And the highways are good today, right? It reaches within 4 days to Delhi versus train, which takes possibly 48 hours. So I think these options we have tried. If somebody has good suggestions, please send it to us. I'll tell you frankly, we have some experts sitting here, I mean, who do it all the time. Embraer is there and Junior is there. And those guys really know this business pretty well in terms of cost and packing and whatnot. So maybe we are missing something. But if you guys have some good idea from competition, from peer companies, we'll be more than happy, because this is actually our third highest cost in the company. After material cost, you know, this comes pretty high on our agenda. So if there's any way that we could reduce cost, for both of us, we'll be more than happy to look at those suggestions. Thank you.
Thank you. This question has come on project execution. When Rital will be able to deliver smooth project execution in the data center projects? Because we always deliver material in parts, and due to this, channel partners are facing issues to get their payment on time, especially on third-party items.
I remember a question which was, which was raked up, I think, in 2019, if not 2020. If I'm not wrong, it was 2019, where we had a similar issue in our SBUB business, which is the power panel business. And I do remember the discussions that I've had with a few partners where, it was certain parts coming, certain parts not coming. So certain actions were taken around that, and we were able to put that in place. As I get a feedback, I practically every 2-3 months I take a feedback on the SBUB, and the feedback has been quite positive. I don't see, except for a rare case where the partner is suffering on account of the dough not going, the side panel not going, etc., which were what was spoken. Having said that, with regard to IT, I take the input. It would be similar because it's a project where we probably we ship the LCPs. We don't send some solutions which are bought out solutions, whether it be fire, whether it be any of the other solutions which are. So we thank you for this question. We shall work around this. We'll try and better from where we are and sort of try and see how we can improve. Yes, I can visualize what the problem is and how you must be getting stuck on that project with your customer. So let's see how we can improve out here. Right now, I take this as a point for our improvement.
Thank you. So there is one more question on TOD. Can we have a more attractive and aggressive TOD plan for partners from the current one?
Well, again, thanks for this question. Well, we can definitely have an attractive, TOD. Now, when we say attractive, actually, what we've done in 2020, and if you all notice, IT, we never used to have incentive. We've started an incentive for them, IT partners. We never used to have an incentive for the SBU system integrators, if I may. Which we've started in 2020. We do obviously have a quantum which we can share with you basis performance. We can rejig within that, the quantum that we'd like to share with you, basis feedback from you. So if one is expecting that the percentages go to 5, 6, 7, 8%, to be honest with you, we don't have that kind of a kitty where we can share. But nevertheless, if the components, because we have two components, one is for the sales turnover and the other are for finer aspects of business, which could be on training, et cetera, et cetera. I'd be more than pleased. I do not know who has shared this question, but irrespective, I would be more than pleased to have your inputs. You can write in directly or through any of our colleagues with an input stating that how you want this the TOD to be changed, we are more than willing to be looking at it within the permissible kitty that we can share with you. I trust this answers your question. We are flexible to that extent, and we are open to hearing from you.
So there is another question on SBUB. Any plans for getting the IS61439 with Schneider LNT components?
Okay, all of us are aware that Schneider has acquired LNT. I was part of the acquisition process when I was in Schneider. So I do know that the strategy of the way forward right now, what is being spoken, that is that it will be two different companies driven as two different companies. I know some of you are L&T partners, so hence this question is quite obvious. You would obviously want to promote the power business products of ours using the switchgear that you otherwise sell, which is L&T in this case. So we are taking it a little bit slow because, first of all, we would want to have Schneider, firm up on their, outlook of how they want to take this acquisition because, the cost of doing these tests to the extent that we do it, in the sense that every aspect of the test is covered so that, nobody can punch holes into the IEC certification that we give you. It costs us somewhere between 1.6 to 1.7 crores for each switchgear manufacturer. Now, it also goes through a rigorous process of almost 6 to 8 months, depending on how you're able to get through each of the tests. So we would give it some more time. At the moment, we are not testing with L&T, but as the switchgear manufacturer, in this case, Schneider, firms up on their policy on what they would want to do or their strategy on what they want to do with the L&T acquisition, we would firm up our ideas on what we'd want to. But having said that, we do have certain ratings of L&T where we have tested for aluminium that can be checked with, and basis that we can quote for some of the requirements. So that shouldn't be a major issue. So to get the entire range of switchgear products tested, you will have to give us certain time, because otherwise it would be investment down the drain, which would be foolhardy to do so. Thank you.
Thank you. So this is on Edge Data Center. Edge Data Center were also for IE channel partners. Any training foreseen this year?
Yeah, I remember that we discussed it 2 or 3 years back that, IT for industrial partners, the IT business for industrial partners. I would suggest have a dialogue with Vinay. I think this question came from Umesh, right?
Yeah.
So I think Umesh, I would suggest, or anybody else, who's interested in taking, because this is not simply training. This is question of commitment to take a business, right? And that means the resources, the right resources. Of course, the training follows it. We did try that with a couple of our, industrial partners, but it never saw the light of the day. And one of the reason is very different segmentation that we work with. In industrial and IT, even earlier, I don't know, Umesh knows about it. He was, by the way, Umesh was VP sales here in Detal. So Umesh knows how we are organized. So our industrial people don't sell IT products. it's been a difficult thing for us, not only in India but everywhere else also. So what I'm saying is, it's difficult to break that barrier. Where industrial focus is very different, and IT focus is very different. So, but we are open. I'm saying that market expansion is our core strategy here. If you believe we have the right strategy to take our products to segment or to larger market, Vinay is the person. Please talk to him, and I'm sure we can discuss it. Training is, of course, an outcome of our engagement on that business. Yeah, thank you.
So this is the last question of the day. I'm getting WhatsApp also, so I've included all of them, which was the current question. So this is the last question. Any plans on identifying the new industries which are coming up, all India, of course, in many industrial areas, so that we can get engaged with them at the initial stage for opportunities in SBU A, B, C, and D?
Good question on how we actually go to the market. So the question is, how do we find out business, for instance, a project of SBUB? Or how do we know that a customer is investing where we have opportunities for SBUA, for instance? C would be slightly different, and I'll address that as well. So what we do at Rital is we subscribe to certain project information from relevant authorities. So you have these organizations which publish project data, and it is not specific to a state. It is across the country. So we subscribe to them. We filter them by state, by projects, by whichever industry they are in, and we share it with our regional managers. Now, this information is used to be ahead of the curve in terms of understanding that there is going to be an investment in that particular territory. And, the first one who makes the first move actually has an upper hand over those projects, because when the groundbreaking, when they have the pollution control certification given by the government authorities, you actually get these projects in this database. So that's how we try and address the projects which are available in the market. Having said that, if you look at SBUC, which is our cooling solutions, it's primarily sold to OEMs, right? If you look at SBUA solutions, are sold to OEMs, are sold to projects, so projects is addressed. It is also sold to automation system integrators. Largely, I've sort of tried to cover where we sell our enclosures. As far as the automation system integrators go, we definitely have the list of system integrators of people like Schneider, Rockwell, Honeywell, etc., where they have a network of partners, and you have some who does the system integration for whichever make. So we are very strong at that to a large extent. So we keep looking at our competitor automation players, list of their partners, and try and make contact with them, which we share with you as well. Our tricky part is with the OEMs. In the sense, though we are strong with the OEMs, how do we sort of increase that base of customers, right? You know what you know, but you don't know what you didn't know anyways. So how do you sort of expand the list of customers from where or what you know? So what we do there is we definitely we track the competitor customers for sure, and that is done very much at a regional level. It cannot be done at a central level. So we have feet on street, which keeps an eye on the list of the competitor customers who are OEMs, where there is a potential. We sort of work on converting them. If they are standard product, it's easier to convert. But if they are complex solutions, then we get it into what we call our fabrication account initiative and try and work on them for conversion. So this is how we sort of address the requirements for the market, being proactive rather than trying to be reactive. So that's how you remain as a market leader. I think I need not sort of say this to you, but that's how we have as a mindset to be proactive in understanding where we can get more business. Well, we did find a gap in the aluminium solutions or in the SBUB solutions at large, because we were addressing only 5% of the market. And that's how we came out with the aluminium in terms of trying to sell enclosures to a gap that we saw. If you find that there are areas where we further want to or where we should work together, you're free to approach us. Give you an example, EV solutions. EV solutions is something new that we are looking at. Energy storage is something new that we are looking at. You have people like maybe a Sun Mobility in Bangalore or Exicom in Delhi, for instance. These are people who are in this industry. They've sort of local fabricators who are supplying to them. At the moment, we are already working with them. We are more than willing to look at newer applications if there are some that you'd like to suggest. And there is one last question. I have a minute more. Which was a part of a question that I saw on my phone, which is to do with not with regard to the question which I just answered, but a question with regard to Tier 2 and Tier 3 expansion. I'm sure you may have missed that question, but with regard to Tier 2 and Tier 3 city expansion of our channel network, we are more than willing to look at our existing channel partners. And the question was, can you consider or will you consider our existing partner for newer territories that you would want to go to, we would be more than happy to have our own to represent us in those territories rather than finding somebody new. So if you find some synergy in a location that you'd want to go to, please feel free to discuss, and we'll be more than willing to work with you in those territories as well. With that, I trust I've answered the first question and I've added to the second.
So I
Thank you.
Just now I got one more question on a WhatsApp. Further to the question of availability of AE boxes, we have placed our order on end December 2020 and we got OC stating that it will be delivered in the first week of February 2021. Is there a production problem?
Absolutely not, actually. So please send us the details of specific order. You know, when exactly the order has been punched in. In fact, we are doing a lot of orders which we are booking in January itself. You know, so unless it's a special SS or something very, very special, if it's a standard product, we're running a 96-97% availability right now. I don't think there'll be any problem in fulfilling that order. Send us the detail to regional colleagues or Kiran Shetty, and I think we'll be able to deliver it.
Right.
Yeah, just to add before, we are currently, we have capacities enough to cater to the requirements. I'm sure Chandra keeps pushing me for sales orders. So if there is a specific case which is taking more time than what it should, please do raise it up. It is our duty to support you. And it would be taken on priority. And Chandra has never said no to me when it doesn't have to come to me. Otherwise, as well, we try and see if there is something where there's lacuna, we shall address it. I have the buy-in from Chandra on that. One more question which came to my mind, which I saw it on the chat. I'm sorry, Sanjeev, I'm taking time. I think it was a question from 3SPS with regard to explosion-proof and fire-proof enclosures. Mention to you that we are in explosion-proof. We have the EXC enclosures, which you are selling at the moment. Your question was whether it can be used for flame-proof. The answer is no. Do we have an offer for flame-proof? The answer is no. You have manufacturers such as SEAG is one which I do remember. I think they're based out of Ahmedabad. There's another company in Chennai which is into flame-proof. Now, what is the difference? In a flame-proof enclosure, you would actually have to channelize the fumes and the flame which actually originates in that environment, which is primarily the oil and gas, etc. These are enclosures which are actually made out of thick material. If I'm not wrong, they're maybe aluminium or it could be some other cast iron material, which is thick in nature. And it's not in the business that we are in. And it also serves as a purpose to handle certain explosions which may be within of the gas. So it's not something which can be a replicate from the CR that we use in our enclosures. So it's definitely not something we are into. So I thought I'll address this question as well. Thank you.
Thank you. So I think that ends for almost 40-45 minutes of question answers. Now we will... Now the next session, which will be on our award ceremony. So we'll connect shortly about it. Thank you again for all of us joining. Thank you. Just a minute. Thank you.